Welcome everyone, this is IM Sagar Shah and today I have with me a guest who's traveled back from China playing some exquisite games. And I'm proud to welcome Karthikeyan Murali who's in Chennai. Hi Karthikeyan.
Oh, hi, hello.
How are you doing?
It's very good, it's all going good.
Well, you traveled like nearly 24 hours from China back to Chennai. But you look so fresh.
Okay, just now I reached my home and it's been like an hour since my... No, it's been like... I got up before 2 hours and just now I am here.
Yeah, so
I'm after getting a bath and just now I'm fresh.
So you are ready for chess anytime?
Yeah, of course, yes.
Okay, so we'll get the chessboard into the picture. What we want to see first is the game that, if I can put it this way, shook the world of chess. Made that move, let me bring that position on the board. But let's first go from the beginning. D4, knight f6, c4, g6. You played the King's Indian defense, which is a part of your repertoire. And when you played this move queen to a5, did you consider this move knight d2 in your preparation?
To be honest, I considered only bishop d3 and queen d2. I didn't consider about knight d2. Sometimes you miss some moves in your preparation. But that doesn't mean that it need to be the reputation. I mean, knight d2 looks good, but I don't know whether it's the correct move or not. Mainly consider BD3 and queen d2 as the main moves. So the line goes on.
You considered these two moves, but Alireza Firouzja surprised you with knight to d2.
Yes.
Yeah. And then when did you start thinking about the queen sacrifice on c3? Was it already playing in your mind now or?
Yeah, after knight d2, I was already thinking of the sac queen c3.
Okay.
I mean, after knight d2, I think cd4 is more or less the obvious move in this position.
Yeah.
Okay, after cd4, knight b3 looks obvious.
Yes.
I mean, because if bd4 and knight c6, I'm getting my knight, I'm doubling my knight with tempo.
Correct.
And that doesn't look as a good sign for white. So, I have to calculate knight b3 as the main candidate move here. So after knight b3, I had basically like four moves. One is queen b4. The main part of queen b4 is if a3, then I want to play queen to c3. I don't know whether provoking a3 is good or not for me.
Okay.
But I thought, okay, let me keep this in reserve. If queen b4, let's say if white plays bishop into d4 and then knight into e4. My queen is not getting trapped. I am getting everything within like... I'm getting everything in time. Like let's say if I play a3 here, then knight into c3, b into c3 and queen e4.
Ah, okay.
So I'm getting everything in time. So I provoking a3, I don't know whether it's a big difference like in the game or I don't know.
Right.
But I thought, okay, it doesn't make much difference. So I had an option is queen b4, provoking a3 and then into queen c3. Other option is like coming back, maybe queen c7 or queen d8, I don't know. Maybe let's say queen d8 and he plays knight d4. It's like the same position, like instead of queen f5, I am playing cd4 and knight d4. It's the normal Muraksi point.
Yeah, exactly.
And actually, I don't want to play this because it's very boring for black. And I have to be like in a very defensive position in this opening. So that's why I rejected queen d8 instantly. Other main option is like queen e5. This looked very promising during the game. Now white has two moves, queen d4 and bishop d4. Otherwise the e4 pawn is hanging.
Correct.
So let's say if he plays queen d4, I was thinking of knight c6, queen e5, knight e5. This lane game looks okay, but comparing to the queen sack, I thought this is very easy for white to play. Like, if in the queen sack variation, it's not easy because my moves are easy, like knight bishop e6, knight d7, rook c8, or maybe knight d7, knight e5, b6, bb7.
Yeah.
In that case, I am playing for like a natural moves, and he has to play some precise moves in that variation. But compared to here, he can play anything. Just say like f3 and knight d5 or maybe rook c1, maybe, I don't know.
Yes.
So I, that's why I rejected queen e5. And the other versions like bd4 is also playable for, right?
Yeah.
Queen e5. So bd4, queen e6 and bd3.
Uh-huh.
Knight c6 and bishop e3. Here I was thinking knight e5 for a long time.
Mm-hmm.
But problem is you play knight d4. Let's say I play knight d3 check, queen d3. I have to come back queen d7 or queen e5 or anything, let's say. And we'll just play short castle. And white has nothing to worry about in this position. He has good center. And I have to already start worrying about my c8 bishop. That, like where to put that.
Yeah.
And I didn't feel that this is a great position for me.
Okay.
So I couldn't like find anything in these two moves, queen e5 and queen d8. So obviously, I thought queen c3 is also a best practical try.
But amazing, like you took this queen, the knight with the queen. What was the reaction of your opponent?
Actually, instantly took b into c3.
Ah, he took it.
Yeah, because it's the only move. You can't play like bishop d2 or any other move. It's the only move, b into c3.
Yeah.
And after d into e3, he thought for like 10 minutes. Then I realized, okay, he didn't like expect this move.
Correct. So he was surprised, but he didn't show it immediately. He first took on c3.
Yeah, he didn't show it immediately because it was the only move. After d3, he was thinking for a while.
Right. So now,
then he realized that, he is surprised by this.
Correct. During the game, you thought it's a good practical try. But now, what do you feel? Do you think if you are given an option again in this position, you would go for it? Is it objectively the best?
Actually, according to me, I would say yes.
Yes, okay.
Yeah, of course, yeah.
Okay, so D into E3. And you know, when I gave this to any computer engine, it says F3 is actually not a good move. Bishop D3 is better. But you know, I personally do not understand how it changes things, because even after bishop d3, black's play remains essentially the same what you did in the game. It doesn't change much. So can you explain this position to us? What do you feel is happening?
Okay, during the game I felt bishop d3 is annoying for me.
Okay.
Because bd3, ef2 check and king f2. Now the point is that his king is not really bad.
Yeah.
He's going to play rook f1, king g1, or maybe rook e1, king g1, and his king is safe.
Yeah.
But during the game, what I thought is like, let's say after ef2 check, king f2. Let's say I play knight bd7 just for ideas. Let's say knight bd7, rook e1. B6, king g1 and bb7.
Yeah.
When I was taking queen to c3, I assessed this position.
Yeah.
And I thought that basically I don't need to worry about anything, because white doesn't have any kind of attacks or doesn't have any kind of ideas to increase position. And I have very like natural moves to play, like knight e5, rook c8 and aim for the c4 pawn. Or I can go for the e4 pawn somehow, like rook c8, knight c5, and I have so many ideas in this position.
Yeah.
But compared to f3, I think this is the best good chance for white to try.
Correct.
Because after f3, my e pawn was a monster and he couldn't coordinate well with the pieces in the center.
Yeah, you suddenly
like,
changed.
You saw during
your
game, he was playing like king d1, king c2. And something like g4, h4, and f1 bishop had no scopes in that portion. In the game. Yeah.
After f3, I thought you would continue normally, like knight d7, b6, bb7, as you just said. But you now changed your plan and you played knight h5.
Yeah. So my point is that in the version in bishop d3, I couldn't exploit the squares in g3 and f4 in the bishop d3 variation.
Correct.
Yeah, because the f file was open, so it doesn't make much use of it. But here the f file is closed, and you can see that the g3 f4 squares are weak. So let's say if there is no pawn on f2, f3 I mean, let's assume that there's no pawn on f3 and no pawn on e3 for black. So let's say I play knight h5 here. I feel that this position knight h5 doesn't make much use for black, because f4 square will be controlled by rook.
Correct.
Anytime we can just sacrifice, let's say, rook and f4.
Yeah.
So that's why I wanted the position to be closed, pawn on f3 and pawn on g2, then I can play knight h5.
Yes.
So I didn't think of knight h5 ideas in bd3 variation, that's why.
Okay. So you went knight h5, queen c1, bishop h6. Where do you think you started to feel you have now a clear advantage?
I think after f3, I felt I am having good advantage after f3.
Okay.
I felt bd3 is the main move which you will play.
Okay.
After f3, I felt I had a good advantage.
So after this position on f3, you itself felt you are better.
Yeah.
And here, your main aim is to just keep making natural moves, or you had some plan to attack the c4 pawn or something like that?
Actually, my plan is like to play knight h5 and play bishop e5, bishop g3 and bishop f2, something like this.
Yeah.
But the main idea of knight h5 is to play bishop e5 in the current position.
Correct.
Let's say he attacks the pawn like something like queen c1, then I want to play bishop e5 check and bishop g3 check and bishop f2. So this was one of my main ideas in this position.
Okay.
So
you mean if let's say white plays, let's just make a move bd3.
Okay.
No, right now c3 is hanging. So queen c2.
Let's say rook c1 maybe.
Okay, rook c1.
Rook c1, I want to play bishop e5 here.
Bishop e5, and now if I somehow try to attack your pawn, queen d3, then you play bg3 check, king e2, or not king e2, king d1, and now
bishop
f2. Okay.
Yeah. This is my main idea. That's why I think you must have saw this and you played queen c1.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So bishop, queen c1, bishop h6, g4, knight f4, king d1, and now you developed your pieces. But what I found surprising was when he attacked your bishop with knight e2 on 20th move, you went back bishop h6 and bishop g7. Did you feel like this was some concession, or you felt now the bishop belonged on the other diagonal?
Yeah, main point of bringing this bishop to this diagonal is to protect my e3 pawn.
Okay.
So when the knight came to e2, my e3 pawn was not attacked.
Yeah.
So I thought that even I lose my e3 pawn, it doesn't matter, because I already developed my pieces and I get some strong attack against the white king.
Yeah.
So I felt that I have to save the bishop. I had to make a decision whether to save the bishop or whether to save the e3 pawn. So I thought I have to save the bishop and give the e3 pawn anyway. If it goes, it doesn't matter, because I already have some initiative against the king.
Correct.
So that's why I thought I have to save the bishop. Because it's king's Indian bishop, you know, it's very important.
Yeah, sure. Yeah. At the end, it did take on c3 and opened up the king. So I think in a way, after your knight e5 took on f3 and then it went back, took on c4. Do you have any improvements for white in this game? I mean, any place you think?
Actually, I think there were some improvements. Let's say like when he played, I think when he played knight c1.
Okay.
Yeah, 19th move for white.
Yeah.
Knight d4 would have made some difference.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, after knight d4, bd7. Let's say a4. Rook c8, and I had ideas like h5 somewhere. I don't remember much. I think h5, yeah.
Okay.
H5 and okay. I don't say that it's better for white, but I think this is the best practical chance for white. That's what I.
Better than doing. The game, yeah.
Better than the game, yeah. Because during in the game he didn't do much. He just passively defended his position, and I had too much activity in the against the c pawns.
Correct.
So during game, I felt knight c1 was not so such a great move. And, even after, let's say, rook f1, bishop to c3, and after 29th move, rook f1.
Yeah.
I felt bishop c3 was dubious after I took it.
Hmm.
Because, okay, I couldn't, I can simplify the position with the 3 pawns for exchange. But there are some stronger moves apart from bishop c3, like let's say rook a5. Instead of bishop c3, I felt rook a5 should also work.
Okay.
Or let's say even bishop g7 should work.
Just keeping the position.
Yes, just keeping, holding on to the position. Let's say queen g1 or queen g3. Just play rook and f1, and I think my position is clearly better here.
Correct.
So, but during the game, I thought simplifying to the pawn for a three, I mean, exchange 3 pawns for a rook, I felt that would be winning for sure. Correct. But it was not easy, as I thought.
Yeah, I mean, before we go to that position, what I liked is when he played 27, bishop g2,
yeah.
He played this move f5, changing the character of the position. Because many times, in such a position, you have these beautiful knights, two great bishops, rook is well placed. It's not easy that now you should do something. You know, you can keep playing around these weaknesses, but you went for it, f5.
So actually, f5 was, you have to open two flanks, as they say. If you are good in a flank, you have to open another flank to create weakness.
Yeah.
So I can actually play like maybe b6 and play rook c8, rook a8, rook gate, rook a8, rook a8 for 10 moves, increase the time, and then I can play f5 again. But I felt this is the right time to play f5 because his pieces are not coordinated. Let's see, the rook on a1 is like misplaced. Rook on b1 is not doing anything. Knight on e2 is not doing anything. Okay, it's different c3, but it's a defensive task.
Correct.
I thought it's the right moment to open up the position.
Sure.
Yeah, so, okay, I could have waited, but this position, f5 looks very promising for me.
Yes. So, f5, gf, bishop f6, and then you took on c3, he took on c5, and the rooks came off. And in this position, after knight e5, 32nd move, he played a5.
Yeah.
You won the e4 pawn as well, because you were winning one of the pawns, knight d4. And here, I think at some point he had some chances with pushing his pawn to a6, yes?
Yeah, actually after 35th move, I played bishop d5. I think that's a dubious move.
Yeah.
But I couldn't find any other moves than bishop d5 because knight e6 check and knight g5 was a threat. Maybe, I don't know, I'm not sure what to play here.
Okay.
Okay, bd5, I thought that if he plays a6, b6, rook a6, I thought as though at the worst case, I can just play king f7 there. Let's say a6, b6, rook a6, king f7.
Yeah.
Let's say he takes rook to a7. I thought I can play knight c6, knight c6 and bishop c6. I felt this should be winning. I don't know how much clear it is, but I thought at least this is a good try. I have 4 pawns for, I have 3 pawns for the exchange.
Yeah.
I felt I can win this.
Correct.
I played a game like this, similar game, similar to this, and I lost with the exchange.
Okay.
And had bishop 3 pawns and he won comfortably. So I thought this is, should be winning.
Okay. So you had things under control, but as it happened in the game after a6, you completely dominated and you brought your king up. and I think this was pretty easy for you, to convert this.
Yes, of course, yes.
I think
I didn't find any difficulties converting this. Maybe some chances for white, but I couldn't find much.
Yeah, the end was beautiful. End was very nice because king f3 is now threatening king f2. The knight cannot move because of knight c2. And the rook cannot move because of knight hanging. So everything is sort of stalemated for him.
Yeah. Okay. Everything was stuck. He couldn't move anything.
So when the game ended, and you won this game, did you feel like you had created a brilliancy?
Okay, if you see from if you see from outside, you will think like it's a brilliant game. But when I was on the board, I thought I just took some practical decisions. That's all.
Correct.
Like queen c3, I took because I had no other choice. It looks very promising, and other moves didn't look promising. So just out of elimination, I took queen c3.
And what about after the game? Did people talk to you about it? Did anyone come to you? There were a lot of Indians playing there, or anyone wrote to you on message, or what was it like?
Okay, I got several applause from my friends, like Aravind, let's say Prague, they are like congratulating after the game.
Mm.
Not immediately after the game, we will be going to play TT as a group.
Yeah.
During that, they were like, oh, what a game, you played very well. Okay, I felt good, but as I thought, it's just a practical decision.
Yes,
the board.
Sure.
Yeah.
Actually, many people even said there was a very beautiful sacrifice for two pieces by Nezmet Dinov. He's
mm-hmm.
a famous master of the past who was famed for his attacking play. And there was this queen into f6 sacrifice which he had made for two pieces.
Yeah.
And people said yours was similar to that game.
thank you. Yeah, I think it's if you feel confident, then you can go for it.
Sure. So this is definitely. Would you say this is your best game till now of your chess career or no?
I would say yes.
Okay.
Because I have never sacrificed a queen like this before.
Yes, sure.
I will say this is one of my best games.
Well, I agree with it, and I'm sure it's going to come in a lot of books, lot of DVDs everywhere. People are going to use this game, and
I hope so. Yeah.
Okay, so one more game which we want to see is your last round win against Maghsoodloo, and the interesting thing is that you had lost two rounds before that. And so, you know, many people felt like the tide was against you. You were not in good form, but you played brilliantly in this game as well. So what was happening before this game and in your mind, you know, because Maghsoodloo is a pretty strong player.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. The junior champion.
Yeah.
He scored something unbelievable in the tournament.
Yes.
Actually, after the two losses, I was not in a very good mood. You know, being a leader in the tournament and you lose consecutively two games in a very bad way. Actually, I was not in a good mood, to be honest.
Yeah.
But I thought, okay, there is still one more round and I have so many chances to qualify for the World Cup. Actually, I cannot make for the title because already one player is on 6, one player is on 6 and off. So maximum I could get to 6 and off.
Hmm.
So I thought, okay, let's just qualify for the World Cup and finish the tournament. So
yeah.
Basically, I just wanted to win this game. Okay. As
To win the game, you're playing black and...
obviously, I just wanted to win every game, that's all.
Amazing. I
just kept making best moves doing games, that's all. Doing the game, I just keep best moves and my opponent made some mistakes.
Well, I would say best moves is perhaps, I don't know that, but you definitely make very strong practical moves. For example, I was at the Mayor's Cup yesterday in Mumbai that was going on. I was talking to an Indian GM and he said that in the game against Maghsoodloo, when Karthikeyan had so much at stake, you know, the World Cup spot and everything, he still went ahead in this position and took Rook into f3. Was this an easy decision for you?
Yes, on the board it was very easy because my e5 pawn was hanging. The c5, I think I have to take Rook into f3. Otherwise, my e5 pawn would fall and he has no weakness basically.
Correct.
So that's why I felt I have to take this Rook into f3.
And after Rook f3, gf3, what do you feel again? Good compensation for you?
Yes. Let's say if his knight was on e4 instead of d5, then I would say that it's not so great for me.
Right.
But the big problem for white is that d5 knight. It has no good squares to go.
Yeah.
He always has to concern about the d5 knight. That's why I thought I can go for this.
Okay. And what was the next critical moment in this game? I think it was around dynamically balanced, the game, but he went wrong somewhere.
Actually, even in the opening, he went wrong. I think after Bishop e3, Knight cd4, I think Bishop d4 was dubious here. At least during the game, I thought Bishop d4 is not a good move.
This is not a good move. Okay.
Yeah, I felt that instead of Bishop d4, Knight d2 was just pleasant for white.
Knight d2.
Yeah, and after this knight coming to e4, and I think white is just better here.
Correct.
So I think this is one of the dubious moves with bishop to d4.
Yeah.
Okay, even after bishop a4, queen a4, cb4, I think c5 is the next dubious move.
Hmm.
Maybe I think here I can go knight d2.
Instead of c5, he could go knight d2.
Yeah, my point is that don't allow rook to f3, that's all. Where I get a very good counterplay.
Yeah, maybe Maghsoodloo was not so afraid of this exchange sacrifice.
Yeah, actually, after the game, he told that actually he didn't consider this much because he thought his king would get defended.
Hmm.
But it's not so because his d5 knight is a huge problem in this position.
So we go on to the game, and
yeah.
I think g6, h4, 26, h4, knight, g7.
Mm-hmm.
He played this move b6. You took knight into b6 and then knight h5. Here, after queen into f3, I think already it's not so easy for black to defend this. White to defend this.
Yeah, actually, after rook g5, queen f3, he played queen d1. This was the correct move.
Yeah.
During the game, I felt that queen d1 should be just better. I mean, after queen d1, queen to d1, rook into d1.
Hmm.
Maybe let's say bg7 or something. Let's say bg7.
Yeah.
And I think black is already fine here.
Correct.
Yeah, black has 2 pawns for the exchange. And he has very good knight, which is going to come on your 4.
Yeah.
Mm, and I felt that it should be good. But both of us had very less time, I think maybe 5 minutes and 6 minutes.
Mm.
So, practically I felt that queen s3, keeping the queens on board would be like not easy for white to think.
Smart decision, yeah. Again, practical. This is what
yes,
I'm saying, yeah?
Yeah.
You made some very good practical decisions in this entire event.
Mm-hmm.
Knight e5, rook f8, and then rook into g6, which he thought he was trying to sort of trap you here.
Yeah.
But you had a trap prepared for him.
Actually, I got confused between the two moves, bishop b3 and rook into f2.
Hmm.
Actually, bishop e3 was just winning on the spot. I got confused. I don't know what I thought here. Bishop e3, f3, knight g3. I thought something like rook g8, I guess.
Bishop
g8,
e3,
f3,
knight g3, yeah.
And I thought rook g8 check, I think. Rook g8, rook into g8.
Hmm.
Knight f7 check, king g7 and queen f3, I think. Basically, after queen f3, there are so many ways to win for black. Let's say rook f8. White's only move is knight g5 and rook into f3, knight s3. And maybe I can even play rook d3 and that knight ending should be winning.
Right.
Or the other move is like knight e2 check after queen f3. That is on queen f3. Knight e2 check was is a very good move. I missed it.
Knight
e2.
Okay.
Yeah, and he can't take with rook because queen is hanging. And if he takes with queen d2, then king d7 check. And black king is getting better.
Amazing.
So he has to play king f2 and queen s2 check. And queen g2, king g2 and king d7 check. And then next time I'll go move knight c3 and I have a piece up.
Amazing.
So this is the variation I should have played. But I don't know, I saw some move or I don't know what I missed and I played rook d2.
Ah, you played rook f2 in the game.
Yeah, in the game I played rook f2. I think this is a blunder. I played very well till this point and I blundered with rook f2.
And then, okay, but maybe...
knight f7 check.
Yeah, in the games that is recorded, they show bishop e3. That's why I thought you played bishop e3.
No, I played rook f2 because I know what I played.
Ah, rook f2 and then what happened?
Actually, blundered with knight f7 check here. Yeah.
Okay.
So, knight f2 check was a blunder. I think just king to f2 was just equal.
Okay.
I have to play bishop e3 check. Otherwise, if queen h4 check, I think king g1. And I have no checks. Because rook on this is controlling everything.
Yeah, this is...
So, bishop e3 check, rook on e3. And d into e3 check, king g1. So, h into g6, knight into g6, king g7, queen h5. And I have no more tries here. I have to go from... queen g3 checking h1 and queen s3.
Okay, this is a draw.
Yeah, this is a draw. But he played knight f7 check. Yeah, he also had very less time, maybe like 30 seconds, 32 seconds or something.
Hmm.
And he played knight f7 check. I have to take rook f7 only move. Rook e8 check and bishop f8. Maybe I think he missed bishop f8. Or I don't know what he missed.
Okay.
If rook f8, yes, rook f8, bishop f8, queen h5. I don't have any mate.
Ah.
Dad bishop of eight, the difference is after queen h5, I have mate on f1, rook f1.
Ah, so now if after bishop f8, he takes queen h5, rook f1 is already mate.
Yeah, rook f1 is already mate.
Correct.
He played, after bishop f8, he played rook g5. And I played knight g3, and it's going to be mate.
Cool.
Yeah. So, actually, I made a mistake in this game, which is we couldn't have to. But, okay, he also he didn't have time and he made a blunder.
Okay. But yeah, this is these two games were, I think, the most critical ones. It was, I think, you played a brilliant event overall.
Okay, thank you.
I think you also now qualified for the World Cup in Khantimansis. Last year, you also played the World Cup because you were the national champion.
Yes.
So this time you qualified through the Asian. Looking forward to it?
Mm-hmm. Thank you very much.
Yeah, that would be a great event. What's next for you now?
Actually, I'm going to play in the Estrakhan Open in Denmark.
Okay.
Which is going to happen in 20 July, I guess, 20 or 19. I am not sure of the dates. And after that, I might be playing Abu Dhabi Open.
Okay.
And after that, I'm not yet sure which one to play.
Okay.
So these two are the main events I'm going to play for now.
So I have two questions for you. My first one is, at the Gibraltar Masters, when you were paired against MVL in the last round, you beat him, you went all out and you beat him. Here, you of course, you played a brilliant game against Alireza, but I think much more competitively difficult was beating Maghsoodloo in the last round because of all the pressure. How do you keep your nerves or how do you keep your confidence?
Actually, during the game, I won't think of any such things like World Cup qualification or let's say prize money or rating about this during the game at least. Because during the game, I just want to calculate best moves.
Right.
If you think of those things and I think you can't calculate those, the correct moves on the game. So during the game, I just go open-minded for to think best moves and that's what you see. That's what happened in the games.
Yeah, of course, you played some great moves. And the second question and the last one I want to ask you is, you are a very good study solver, or you can say a composition solver. Do you also compose problems or just solve them?
Actually, composing problems is not so difficult. Like, I have composed like some helpmate in 3, and I have composed an end game. And I have composed like Elbert in 2, but mainly I'm not into composing problems. I like to solve, of course, but composing problems, I just did like 3 problems, that's all.
Okay.
If I can, I can compose problems.
You
but,
can compose, but it's not your main interest.
Yeah.
But how do you become better at solving studies? Because I think you solve also very quickly. I've asked many people and they say if you give a position to Karthikeyan, he quickly finds what is the key element in the position and solves these compositions or studies very quickly.
Yeah. So the main thing is calculation. And there are some methods for that. Like one of the best method I would say is the process of elimination. Like let's say you see some 3 or 4 candidate moves and you don't know what to select. At those times I will just eliminate which is bad. Like you saw in the earlier game, after knight b3 I saw four main moves, which is queen b4, queen e5, queen d8 or queen c7 let's say. The other moves doesn't look promising and I just checked queen c3 whether I am missing something there and I found nothing, so I just went for queen c3. So one is process of elimination.
Right.
Other one would be like screening. Screening means like checking every moves. If you don't know which one to consider, check every moves possible. That's what I do. I mean every logical moves. Let's say in Alireza game, knight b3, I want to play moves like d3 or d3 directly, losing the queen.
Sure.
So just considering every logical move and then taking a decision.
So first thing is to screen for most logical moves, and after that you should try for the method of elimination, that you remove the ones which are not good, or you don't like, and then go for the main one. I think it requires a lot of practice. Yeah.
Yeah. Actually, you can just train it during your training session, or maybe when you find time, you can just practice it.
Yeah, you had some material. Have you your favorite material which you use for training these things? Do you recommend something?
Actually, I don't have any material.
Do you recommend some book or some something which you have used before?
One of the main books I like for this method, I mean for this methods, is like imagination in chess. I found it very useful for my calculation.
Imagination in chess. Okay, I think people should keep make a note of it. It's written by Patag Aprindashvili, book, and that can help you with this. So, yeah. Karthi, thank you so much for giving your precious time.
You
traveled from China. You must be tired. So take some rest. Enjoy your success, and we'll see you back in action at the ExtraCon Open.
Yeah, thank you very much. It's been a great time listening games with you.
Thank you.
Thank you.